This program is going to teach us how to use Inkscape for teletherapy and virtual learning. First, what is Inkscape? It's a free and open source vector graphics editor. It can be used to create or edit illustrations, diagrams, line arts, charts, logos, and complex paintings. But this presentation will demonstrate an alternative use. We're going to use it as a board where materials such as book pages, sight word pictures, and tools such as phonic faces can be layered to enhance learning. Inkscape enables you to layer different materials such as a book page or pictures or phonic faces or worksheets, sight words, etc. on the same page. Zoom features enable you to focus on any part of the tablet surface. The zoom features built into Inkscape, that is. Arrows, boxes, lines can be used to point to words or pictures to focus the attention of the participants. So show kids or your interaction partner what you want them to actually be looking at. And then two or more screens can be opened. So you have one work screen and one or more material storage screens to use during the session. This visual presentation will demonstrate the basic strategies and commands needed to create and make an Inkscape presentation. A free manual can be downloaded on elementory.com. YouTube and the internet also have multiple sources of help with Inkscape, which is how I taught myself. So have a great learning experience for yourself and those you work with. You can have a free download of Inkscape. So there's this link for the Windows download and for the Mac download. Elementary has the word mentor in it, thus the O. You can get a free copy of the Linkscape tutorial that I created at that site. You can also download a free Phonic Faces book called Theo's Thanksgiving. You can also download free phonics articulation worksheets. And also there are Phonic Facebook, sight words, and alphabet that can be purchased in paper or electronic formats at elementary.com. Okay. I have several things opened, obviously. All right, this is the Inkscape tutorial. So it's going to talk about why you can use it and how to set up your Inkscape windows, how to turn on the tool control bar if you don't see it, the pick tool and how to use it to rotate objects or move objects or select objects. How to use cursors to change sizes and shapes. How to rotate or flip objects. How to move objects up and down the layers. How to move the windows with the scroll bar, how you can type letters and words of all kinds of fonts. They have more fonts than I've ever seen. How to change the font, create and save additional windows, opening a file from a folder, importing objects, copying and pasting objects across two Inkscape files, highlighting words or objects using a line, using a square, and storing objects, entering book pages if you don't onto Inkscape, how to correct lopsided pages, locking an object in place, and then shortcuts. So all of those things are included. And that's the kinds of things that you would need to do. So let's just go ahead and get started. I set up partial board. So when you open Inkscape, this is what it basically looks like. There's a window that you can use. I usually use the window. When I have a book, I copy the pages and put them in the book or in the on the window. I put the pages of the book above it so that when I'm done with this page, I can move it out of the way and bring down another page that I want. And then you can see these little arrows in the corner. I can grab a corner and I can pull it and that will enlarge it. You have to make sure this little lock is set. I'm going to unlock it and I'm going to try to pull it and I can pretty easily distort the picture because it's not enlarging it proportionally. I'm going to use Control Z to get back to the original status and then I'm going to lock it and now it's always proportional. So that lock is an important thing to remember when you're doing this. This is the way that I've set up the board to work with a child. So I've got a little story. I've got these sight words, can, yours, it's for this page, so that I can teach children to pay attention to the first sound of words. And then also the meaning of the word. So can is a happy face with a thumbs up. I can do it. So when you've got a little one who's just starting to learn how to read, you can actually teach the letter sounds by looking at the first letter of the words. So this is something that I might use with a pre-K child or a kindergarten child. Learning to the letter sounds and learning to recognize that there are words, etc. You can see that my words have a different colored background. That way I can scramble them, add a couple more words in there, and I'll say, okay, can you find the words and make the words say can yours? And if they just put it in this order, then I can read it. Yours, ear, can, doesn't make sense. We're trying to find out if the ears hear it and it asks, can yours? So, okay, let's move the ear back over here. And which word comes first, the one in green or the one in brown? They, you know, can't point, and so they have to have a way of identifying what letter they're talking or what little word they're talking about. So that's why they're on colored backgrounds. So then they'd say, oh, first the green word and then the brown word. You notice that when I overlap them, one of the words disappeared. That's because the whole program is on layers. So I can layer things. I can make sure that my words can go above my book level. The layers are controlled up here. So you see these little icons up here. This one is measuring it all the way to the top. This one measuring it all the way to the bottom, and these are inside layers. So if I really wanted my can on top, then I can click on the can and move it to the top. Or if I want the can on the bottom, I can move it to the bottom. Same with yours, I can move it to the bottom, then I can move it to the top. So those are, you know, how you can layer things and keep your layers straight if your objects go under each other. So if this one got caught underneath and it's like, oh no, I wanted that letter, I wanted that word, then I can just pop it up to the top and there it is. Okay. We also have things like question marks to make the kids aware of question marks. So we can say, you know, he's asking a question. Can your eyes see it pop? Can your ears hear it pop? Can yours? All right. Put that back. All right, these are other things. These letters are called phonic faces. They help kids understand that letters make sounds. So this one shows that you take your two lips and you make a popping sound. Pop, pop, pop. This one shows that vowel makes the ah sound. You can see the little uvula hanging down. So it makes the ah sound like you would have at a doctor's office. Say ah. Okay, and then the little word would tell the kids to pop your lips, ah, and try to hear the word. Once they can hear the word, then you can ask them to think of some rhyming words. What if I change the first letter to a sound, to a t sound, to a m sound? So you can teach rhyming, you can teach sound blending, you can teach sound in isolation, you can do all those phonemic awareness kinds of activities using some of the words in the book. So this says, Peter's eyes see it pop, talking about the popcorn. Can your eyes see it pop? Okay, so again, it's very flexible. You can move things around, you know, very easily. So now we're going to talk about setting up a board. All right, I'm going to do the command control N as in new. So if I do a control N, I'm going to get a new board. So this is where you would start. I like to automatically go up there and set the lock. All right, now I wanted my window, my little screen, to basically be landscape instead of portrait. So I'm going to go to File, and I'm going to go to Document Properties. And way over in this corner, it says Landscape. And that's all I have to do now. I can close that. So now I've got a landscape screen here. I'm going to go to the magnifying glass to zoom it up. So I'm going to go to the pluses over here, and I'm going to make it a little larger. I can move my view of the window up and down and back and forth just by using these scroll bars. If they ever disappear, which they have for me, I don't know what I did to cause them to disappear, but Control B as in boy or back brings them back. All right, so those scroll bars can, you know, move things for you. All right, now I'm going to go to PDF. I'm going to keep making my view smaller until I get everything on a page. So this is just Adobe. So the little story is Peter pops popcorn, pop, pop, pop. So all the way through the little story, you have opportunities to make the p sound, that his mouth makes a p sound. So he's popping the popcorn, Peter pops popcorn, pop, pop, pop. And Peter's ears hear it pop, 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 can yours? Peter's eyes see it pop, 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 can yours? Peter's nose smells it pop, can yours? Peter's fingers feel it pop, can yours? Peter's mouth tastes it pop, can yours? All right, so I'm going to go, we left off with the see it, so I'm going to start making some new pages. I'm going to go up here to edit, this is in Adobe, and I'm going to take a snapshot, and I'll get this little crossbar, it's a very faint crossbar, and I'm going to choose what I want that snapshot to be. And then I'm going to go into Inkscape and just do Control V. And there's my page. Now remember, I want that locked. Otherwise, I can distort the page pretty easily. So I'm going to lock it and get it the size that I want it. All right. Let's do one more just to show again the effect. Peter's mouth tastes it pop. I'm going to go to edit, take a snapshot. And close. what I want. Go back over here. And size it up or down. All right. I'm going to move this one above the board. I only want to work on one at a time. Okay. Now I can turn, whatever is clicked, this little arrow key over here, the select key. You select the object, and that's the one that you're making transformations, or you're changing, or you're moving. So this just shows that I can move it around clockwise and counterclockwise. I can move it up and down, upside down. I can move it backwards and forwards. So now the print is backwards, and now the print is correct. So I can do those kinds of transformations. I can also double click it, and now you've seen the little arrows turn into these curved arrows. Let's do that again. Straight arrows, click it again, curved arrows. And so now I can rock it any number of degrees that I want. This is helpful when your PDF wasn't straight when you put it on. So basically, I'll draw myself a straight line. If I have a crooked PDF snapshot, and then I'll line it up, and I can move, can nudge it a little bit one way or the other to line up the text appropriately. Mine were pretty straight. Okay, now I can also use this line that I've created to help children follow along on the text. So I can say, all right, let's look at the words above the line and tell me what you see. What's the first word? What's the next word? What's the last word? So I can use that line. If I don't want it to be a gray color, I can hit the shift key. I can hold the shift key down and choose any color I want. So now it's a red line. I can shift key, pick a color, and now it's a pink line. Oops, I have to make sure I have it clicked first. There we go. Now it's a pink line. Select it again. Shift color. Now it's a blue line. So anything that I draw, I can change the color just by using the colors at the bottom. If I draw a square, then I can just choose a color. So now it's green, now it's blue, now it's another color of green. This bottom scroll bar moves the color bar. Now it's pink, now it's burgundy, now it's yellow. Okay, so if I just hit the color, it's going to change the color shape. If I hold the shift key down, I'm now going to change the outline shape, or the outline color. So now it's light blue, now it's green, now it's red, now it's burgundy. Okay, so I can, you know, do those kinds of things. I decide that I really want a little box that I can put around the word, but obviously you can't see it. So I'm going to make sure that it's selected. And then you see this X at the far left of the colors, that means no color. So now I've made myself a little box that I can use to highlight a word or highlight something that I want to show the kids. Okay, and I can make it any size I want by using those arrow keys to make it larger or smaller. If I want to focus on something close, then I'll go back to my magnifying glass and I'll make it as large or as small as I want. And I can use the scroll bars to put in focus, whatever it is that I want to focus on. Let's see. And if I lose my little box, it's probably hiding behind somewhere. So I can just take my cursor And I can see there's a hidden object under there, so I can pull it to the top. If I want to group some of my objects together, so if I wanted to right now, my board and my line and my box are all separately moving things. If I want to put them together, then I can hold my shift key down and activate both things, and then I can go control G for control group. And now they function as a single object because I've grouped them together and made them one object. Okay, if I do control U, it will ungroup them, and I'm back to separately moving objects. Okay. So those are, you know, some of the real basics. If I want to type something, so if I want to type some rhyming words, hop, top, I can, oops, wrong screen. I can select it, move it to the side over here. There we go. So it's out of the way. The A for alphabet. Hop, top, mop. So we can make our rhyming words, etc., down the side of the page. So those are, you know, some of those things that you can do just with the screen itself. You can change the size of the letters. You can change the, you know, depth. You can do a variety of different things. If I want my line, for example, a thicker line, I can go to the bottom of the screen. I'm gonna make this smaller. Okay. Fill is the fill color, and stroke is the outline color. So if I want to make my outline color broader, wider, then I'm going to double click on that. And it takes me to this page where I can make adjustments. So I'll do stroke style. And you can see that I can make dashes and other kinds of dotted lines. All I'm really going to do is change my thickness of my little line that I'm using. So I'm going to make it that a 3. Okay. So then when I go back, scroll and find it, you can see it's much thicker than it was before. And if I do control Z, I can get it back to the thickness that it was before I made the change. That control Z only works immediately after you've made a command. Otherwise you would have to go back in and change the thickness again on your own. All right. So now I have a pretty good board. I'm going to use my zoom key. I'm going to go over here, and it looks like a little horizontal square, and that sort of centers everything again. All right, so I've got a pretty good tool right now, but it's like, oh wait, this child doesn't know the alphabet yet, and I'm asking them to look at these letters and they don't know the letter sounds yet. That's one of the goals, is to teach them the letter sounds. So what are some of the things that I can do? Well, that's when I have alternative boards set up. So okay, these little squares, as I said, this is one of my alternative boards that I just use as a tool board. So I'm going to pull in some of these colors, control C, control V, make them a little bit smaller. Okay, you cannot copy a JPEG directly into this. You have to import JPEGs. So I'm going to go control I for control import, and that's going to send me to my little page of JPEGs that I have. So now we're working on smelling. So I'm going to import my nose figure. Okay, I can either, you know, click on it and then do open. Okay. And it puts it on the page, or control import. We should have smell. I'm going to double click on it, and now it takes me to that page. So whether you double click or do the two-step thing, you basically are going to import the JPEG. I want them a little smaller. I'm just going to stack them on top of each other to do it all at once. Make sure that you have the lock set. Okay, now I can put it, use my arrow keys on my computer to center it a little bit, choose a color where I want to put these. All right, now I'm going to take my cursor and surround both of them at the same time and do Control G, and that makes them a group. If not, when I try to move this one, then it moves apart. But if I try to move this one, they're grouped together as one object. So, all right, I'm gonna also put my cursor around those two and do control group. All right, so now I've got something that I can use with the kids. So I'm gonna pull up my Peter as well, control import. And I'm going to find Peter, double click on him, okay. I'll make him blue, make him a little bit smaller. I can also go up here if I'm futzing around with the sizes. As long as this is locked, it'll also change them proportionally. So instead of a 41 width, I'm going to do a 39 width. And that made it smaller. Use my arrow keys to move it in there, control group. All right, so now we can start talking about it. Peter's nose smells. I'm gonna get rid of this for the moment. Okay. So if I'm working with my little ones, we can start talking about this word. This word is Peter. Look, it starts with the p, p, p. So the letter P means put your lips together and pop the sound, p, p, p. And you can see it at the beginning of his name, Peter. Ooh, and there's an E sound, P-t-t-er, Peter. Letters tell my mouth what to do, p, p, Peter. And then we have the nose. Look, that N, letter N, looks like his nose. I make that sound by putting air in my nose. Woom, woom, woom. Can you make that kind of engine sound? Woom, woom, woom. Nose, nose. You can see that air coming out of his nose. Mm. And when you smell, the smell goes up your nose, nose. And smell, smell. That's that little snaky sound. Smell. You can see the air going up her nose as she starts to smell. All right, I'm going to mix up the order of my words. And tell me which color of word goes first. Which word says Peter? Which one starts with that p? Sound. Oh, that's right. His mouth is going pop, pop, pop. Now, nose, nose. That N tells me that the sound goes up his nose. Who can find that? And you can open that and then smell, etc. Now, you'll notice that this has some morphemes on it. So there are some morphemes if you want to introduce those to the kids. So if they're just learning their letter sounds, I don't usually put the morphemes on them. But when you've got kids who are starting to sound blend and be more aware of them, then I'll bring the morphemes on there. So we've got the plural and the possessive. Control C, Control V brings them off of that screen and onto this screen. So I copied and pasted from my storage file. So now I can say, oops, Peter's possessive. And smells should have been the verb S. So we'll try the present tense verb S, Control C, Control V. There we go. I can overlap them a little bit so that they can see it. Okay, so, oh, look, the snake is coming out of her mouth because the snake belongs to her. So this is something that's going to belong to Peter. Apostrophe S means something belongs to you. So it's Peter's nose. His nose belongs to Peter. And he's smelling right now. You can see this little clock on the snake's head. That means something is happening right now. So anyway, it's just visual ways of showing children all of those different kinds of things. When it asks the question, can yours, I can go over to my little board once again, and this time I can pick the question mark. Control C, Control V. Can your nose smell the popcorn? Can yours, and you can talk about the question mark. He doesn't know, he's thinking. He doesn't know, so he's got to think about it. And that thinking sign looks like the question mark. Okay, so you can see that there's lots of, you know, layers that I can put together and lots of things that I can move around all on that same screen, which is what I really love about Inkscape. It's just wonderful for this kind of teaching. The other thing are the phonic faces that I use also with the kids. So I'm gonna get some of this stuff out of the way. I can just move it down to another place where I can use the scroll bar. To move it down faster. There we go. I just took my cursor and drew a encapsulated all of that stuff and then just moved it all down as one big lump. Okay, so now I can use the phonic faces if I want to look at things in more detail. So I can say, all right, let's look at the words nose. And the first sound is going to be a n sound. Now I have to go Control C, Control V, oops, Control C over here and Control V over here. These usually won't slide down, they won't slide across screens. If you cause yourself to lose that screen, again, don't panic. You just go up here and I'm gonna find the magnifying glass and I'm gonna find, because that's, it makes it smaller or larger, and I'm going to find the little triangle, and that should pull it back into the screen again. So it's not like it, you lost it, you just sort of moved it around when you did what I just did. All right, so I'm back to my pick with my select tool. Move this back. All right, now I'm going to do that. You can see that there's two O's. There's the baby O, ah, and there's the long O, oh. Ah, oh, ah, he gets his throat tested, ah, and now the O can make the perfect O operatic note. So I'm going to Control C, Control O. All right, move it over a little bit. And now we're going to get the S. This S is drawn to be more like your tongue shape. For articulation, for those of you who are speech therapists, There's the S that just looks like the letter, and then there's the S that looks a little more like the tongue shape. Okay, so we can talk about, you know, making the sounds now. Let's try to blend this out. N-O-S. N-O-S. And you ask, what about the E? Well, he's silent. And so we can move him up there, but his mouth is zipped shut, so we know he doesn't make a sound. So listen, you guys, let's try to make these three sounds. We're going to put Mr. O over here because he's just silent anyway. N-O-S. N-O-S. Can you hear that word? What word am I saying? N-O-S. So you help them listen to it until they can hear it. Then you can compare it to the sight word. See, it's the same as this. The N makes the first sound, and then the O's goes up his nose. Nose. So those are, you know, different things that I layer when I'm working with kids, either for articulation or for reading. Usually I work on them both simultaneously. So I can, you know, just keep layering different things, especially when I have these screens. You can see that there's past tense markers, etc., long and short vowels. A says, ah, she's an unhappy baby, but the grown-up says, A, because she's happy. The baby is getting his first tooth. He says, eh. Now Mr. E says, E, he has all of his teeth. Eh, E. She doesn't like carrots and says, eh. Now she has to wear eye glasses because she didn't eat enough carrots. Eh, I. Oh, and baby you is the good thinker. So now she can tell you all the answers, and you as pairs. And there are faces for any things like the oo sound, or the as in loose, or as in look, oi, aw sound, ow sound, and ch, sh, etc. So I can, you know, do any of those kinds of things and teach my phonics rules. There's the two vowels go walking, and we see that we can silence Mr. E. All right. What else do I want to show you? I mean, that's, you know, basically how I use Inkscape and how I set it up. As I said, you can get that PDF on how to use Inkscape on the elementary website. And a lot of these materials are available on that elementary website. And there are some free phonics sheets and some other kinds of things on that elementary website. So that's about it. Hope you enjoy Inkscape.